And I'm back. Greetings, everyone. This is Lucian Vulsan, and welcome to episode 5 of Freedom Alternative Interviews. I'm here with Hannah Wallen of the Honey Badger Brigade. Now, well, a few words about Hannah. She has emerged on the radar as Della Burton around 4 years ago and kept her face and name private for quite some time due to her direct involvement in several cases of false domestic violence allegations in which, well, spiteful women lied about being abused by men who've done nothing wrong, and the supposedly patriarchal judicial system simply listened and believed. There's links in the low bar if you want to read more about that. And, you know, since then, Hannah has gathered quite a sizable amount of work, both online and offline. And by the way, Hannah will not be having a video because technical problems. But if you want to see how Hannah looks like on camera, you can go on her channel. I'll link to that in the low bar as well. And with that, welcome to the Freedom Alternative Interviews, Hannah.
Hello.
How's it going?
Oh, it's pretty good. We had a interesting show last night, interesting Honey Badger radio show last night.
Yeah, and we'll get to quite talk about that. So, yeah, let's get to know you a bit. I mean, without getting into all the details, again, details, you can read that in the low bar. Tell us about a few things about yourself. How did you become active in this very un-PC and unprogressive and reactionary corner of the culture?
Well, without going into all the details, because that takes quite a bit to discuss, I went through a series of experiences. Like, a lot of people talk about, you know, learning about men's issues as being red-pilled, where you have this moment where you have the wool pulled away from your eyes and you start to realize the way that the system actually treats men, the way government systems and social systems discriminate against men.
You mean there is no patriarchy?
Yeah, but I got to see it a little bit at a time, sometimes towards just members of my family, a lot towards my husband, and quite a bit towards my friends. And eventually got to the point where I had gone from being non-feminist as a youth to anti-feminist as a teen, and as an adult, you know, being aware of men's issues to actually becoming a men's rights activist. And then in the middle there, I was a father's rights activist as well. And I think my first foray into the men's rights movement really was seeking out father's rights organizations during my family's custody issues. And that sort of led me into more and more into learning about activism in towards changing laws and reforming conditions that men face that cause discrimination in family and criminal court. So it's been quite a long journey, actually.
All right. Let's talk about a bit more about that journey and about your work in general. Now, you've written in numerous places, starting with your blog, Breaking the Glasses, if I remember correctly. Mm-hmm. But you're now mostly focused on HBR, on Honey Badger Radio. So please explain first to my audience what HBR is, because I suspect that a significant portion of my audience is not necessarily familiar with that. And then what is your involvement there?
Well, Honey Badger Radio is part of the Honey Badger Brigade's initiatives. And the radio part of it is discussion, online discussion, that sort of is there to help highlight issues of men's rights issues, social issues related to men and boys, including, you know, health issues. And we talk about boys' issues in education. So it's not necessarily all related to legal reform. Some of it's also related to social reform and just general social awareness. And then in conjunction with that, we're also an anti-censorship organization. And
you mean you don't want to censor things that are harmful?
Yes, we don't want to censor things that are harmful.
By being harmed?
But in addition to that, we also have the blog, which I'm the editor of the blog. So we have that going on, and there's also animation and artists that are creating cartoons. So we're basically a whole team of artists and writers and animators and speakers and commentators that are all focused on promoting the interests of men and boys, and sort of catching them up with the way culture's left them behind. And you sort of see some information about that in our mission statement and in our Badger Festo. Our mission statement is on our YouTube channel, on the Honey Badger Radio YouTube channel. And the Badger Festo is on the blog. It's a little more tongue-in-cheek than the mission statement. The mission statement is more serious because we wanted to explain why we are, why we're incorporating, not just, you know, going about this in a happy-go-lucky, skip down the road kind of manner.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, it's usually the case with these kinds of organizations. Once they become big enough, they would have to incorporate somehow, although that doesn't apply to every country, but it usually is the case that they have to incorporate. I guess that's not necessarily well received by some of the fans, isn't it?
Well, there's been a couple of complaints, but it's a matter of two things. First of all, we have to protect the income of the organization from being treated like one person's personal income and vulnerable to any seizure of that individual's personal property. And then we also have to protect the individuals from having that income treated as their personal income and being treated as liable for, like, we don't want Alison treated as liable for things I say, or Karen treated as liable for, you know, a cartoon somebody takes offense at that, say, Brian made. Although I think Brian's probably about the least offensive person I've ever met, you know, aside from my husband, who is a sweetheart, but who has the same name, which is funny. But in any case, So we had that, and we have the other aspect of this is, of course, taxes. If, you know, we want to be able to get into a position to pay people for what they're doing so that they can dedicate their time to this instead of taking time away from it to go work a minimum wage job, and, you know, then we have to be able to treat the income as a business income. Otherwise, you pay the individual and then you're still taxed on it as personal income. And that's expensive. And it would be poor stewardship of Honey Badger Radio's resources, the Honey Badger Brigade's resources, if we allowed ourselves to be double tapped by the government.
Now, for the record, I was around. I can't say I was there, although, well, most of these things occurred online when the Honey Badger Brigade was formed. I mean, I still remember playing Hannah's commercials on my show, Voice of Europe, on AVFM. So, yeah, I mean, we go quite a long way back. Now, you mentioned that in the Honey Badger Brigade, you also have artists who make cartoons and whatnot. And that pretty much leads us to the, takes us to the logical next topic. Well, Gamergate. Definitely the Honey Badgers were involved in that. By the way, another point of information, Honey Badger is essentially female non-feminists. That's what the term was supposed to mean. Well, anyway, so tell us about your involvement in Gamergate and nerd culture in general.
Well, I first became aware of Gamergate after the Gamers Are Dead articles came out and the hashtag was created. I became more aware of the consumer revolt end of it. But I'd been watching discussion of Quinspiracy prior to that because Reddit, Men's Rights Reddit, had been discussing issues of sort of a social justice invasion of both tabletop and video gaming culture. Oh, for a couple of years before that. I still reference a three-year-old post. I think it's about three years old now, in which there was discussion. I had a comment that I think it was my first time being acknowledged as a female by Man Boobs when he quoted me and called me a special snowflake in this discussion, where we were talking about the social justice invasion into gaming and this it was mainly feminism we were discussing, of course, but this need to dictate how male gamers are allowed to behave as part of their own culture and part of their own hobby and everything by sort of new coming female gamers. And I was really, when I started seeing this happening, I was really miffed because, you know, I'd been there for 20 years and they were acting like girls were a new thing in gaming and it was just not welcoming to girls and how dare they not let girls in. And, you know, I've been playing Dungeons and Dragons since 1987. So I, you know, I said in the comment, I'm not really a video gamer because I didn't want to, I'm not a hardcore gamer. I'm, as far as video games are concerned, and more of, I guess you would call me a filthy casual. and I'm more of a retro gamer than a modern game player too. So it's a double whammy there. But I have been very much aware in the tabletop arena of the mistakes you can make as a person with a chip on your shoulder or as a person with oversensitivities, because I've been there. And, you know, I figured out that it was more fun basically to just be there and be part of the group and enjoy yourself. And if people start shit talking, you shit talk back and you play the damn game. And so when Gamergate started up, I looked at that as just a larger scale experience of gaming that was very similar to mine. And like the other Honey Badgers, some of them are gamers and some of them are not. But everybody was able to look at the phenomenon that was taking place and see the value in what was being done there and the need to support it and promote it and be a part of it in order to help it happen. And I ended up writing an article, Social Justice War Games. I got to remember the title of it now. I thought I had it. It was Journalism is a Social Justice War Game, at about the battle that was basically taking place between games journalists who considered themselves a higher tier of nerd and gamers who they looked down on as being, you know, more socially inept and less important nerds. Yeah, the plebs. And that sort of was the Honey Badger's introduction to Gamergate. And so we did everything pretty much that that the movement did. You know, there were some of us that were involved in sending emails to organizations and to advertisers related to corruption in various aspects of media and various aspects of the industry. We helped provided a lot of coverage for the initiatives and everything. We talked about them on the show. And you know, we had people on to discuss what they were doing and so on. We signal boosted, which, you know, retweeting things and so on. So, and then we went to keep wanting to say conference. We went to Calgary Expo.
Yes, please talk about that.
Now that was an interesting experience. We basically went and like initially Allison was just gonna, you know, take us there as an artist group. And then we got more involved in Gamergate and everything. We realized that this was an opportunity to bring that message forward, the anti-censorship message and the anti-corruption message with us. So instead of just sending a person or two to a booth to talk about ourselves, we did a fundraiser to send a larger group that could talk about more than just, you know, just what we were doing as Honey Badgers and actually sort of bring a full message, an anti-censorship message, a pro-consumer message, a pro-men's rights message, a pro, you know, a pro-egalitarian message. And, you know, this was something that it evolved from the minute that we started to the minute that we arrived. And you could sort of tell by the way the booth was set up, where we had a lot of the Gamergate related display set so that it would be seen from all angles. And we had quite a bit of discussion with people, and it was really interesting the way people approached us. There were people that were afraid to come talk to us because they were afraid they were going to be harassed for it. They literally came up to us with their shoulders hunched and their heads down, shuffling up like somebody that would maybe we should be talking about this out back in the alley so that nobody sees us and knows, you know, that we're here so we don't get in trouble.
Why is that? You weren't selling cocaine or something. I mean,
no, we were selling something much, much scarier. We were selling freedom of choice.
Oh my God, that's oppressive.
Yes, terribly offensive. People hate that idea if they are involved in social justice, because most people who exercise freedom of choice don't choose social justice. And we were there for a day.
It seems to be quite a pattern, isn't it?
Yeah. We were there for a day, and Allison and Sage went to a panel, Women into Comics. And the great irony of this, Allison, as a woman, stood up to answer to a question that was asked about men's rights activists. Mm-hmm. You know, they said something to the effect of, well, we don't understand why men's rights activists don't like us. And they were talking about feminists. And Allison asked if she could field that question. And they said yes. And she said, because I'm a men's rights activist, so you can hate on me. And they acknowledged her a second time. And then she went ahead and told them why men's rights activists dislike feminists. And, you know, it's basically because they portray women as victims all the time. Mm-hmm. That we can't be anything but victims. And they were horribly offended by this, apparently. But they didn't display that at the time. There was a lively discussion for about 5 minutes. And then the panel went back to its regularly scheduled discussion. And that was that. Next morning, we got booted from the conference for violating conference rules by, you know, according to what they said afterwards, because they really didn't tell us much at the time. In fact, asking questions was discouraged. They hadn't, nobody talked to us at all about this. There was no investigation. There was nothing but us being approached by guards and police to get out. And they rushed us to get out before people came in and saw what they were doing. They really tried to make it a hidden thing. They didn't want most of the patrons of the conference to see them kicking a group of mostly women out of the conference, out of the convention. So basically we got kicked out for being non-feminist. We got kicked out for questioning somebody's assessment of us. We got kicked out for not just letting a statement about who we are stand, you know.
Yeah, but you know, questioning is triggering, Hannah. I'm sure you can understand that.
And well, what that ended up doing, the benefit of us getting kicked out was that it shined a spotlight on Gamergate in some more mainstream press. There were media outlets that contacted us that hadn't. They had no idea what Gamergate was. And so we talked about our situation, but then, you know, we explained some of why we were there and everything. And then these new media organizations had to kind of go through and look into what Gamergate itself was and what the consumer revolt was about and what the response of the consumers involved in the revolt had been. And so it kind of created a little bit of promotion for the actually quite a bit of promotion for the revolt itself.
Yeah, that's how I view things as well. I think it is better that you were kicked out, because had you not been kicked out, fewer people would have learned about the rest of the baggage. Because as you said, I mean, these things got way out of hand, just like social justice invasion got way out of hand, because it extends to several other topics, not just games, not just comics.
Right.
Last night, for instance, I was Googling, not last night, two nights ago, I was Googling a solution for a Linux problem. And on that tiny forum, which is exclusively for hardcore geeks, who customize their Linux distros and whatnot. I mean, it's not for everybody. there was still a social justice wanker there complaining that the guidelines for the user was like, and the user can do that for himself or something like that. And that's allegedly a gendered slur. Now, in that particular community, the answer was, why don't you go fuck yourself? But but in other communities, sadly, these wankers were not treated like this. Quite the opposite. They were welcomed with open arms.
Which, I've heard some things about that. My opinion is equivalent
of suicide, but whatever.
Yeah, I've heard some things about that. That like one of the sort of pioneers of the use of Linux, by more, you know, average people who are not necessarily big programming geeks, was attacked by social justice warriors.
And threatened with a false rape allegation and whatnot. Yeah.
Yeah, that's what I had remembered reading, was that they tried to build a case for false rape allegations, and he's actually seen this happening to some other men in the community. This is actually something that, you know, this is stretched throughout geek culture and nerd culture. It's really, we've even into areas that are not traditionally thought of as a geek culture, but they really are, like music, and particularly rock music, heavy metal. And my argument for why heavy metal is geek culture.
Don't get me started on metal.
I'm going to be real brief here. My argument for why heavy metal is geek culture is because you have to study something that is intensely cerebral. You have to really study to understand producing music.
It's like opera music.
It really is.
Even for the listeners. I mean, you can't really appreciate I don't know, let's say Wagner, without knowing a bit, a thing or two about that particular kind of music. Same goes with metal, and particularly more extreme versions, like Black or Death.
Or
symphonic epic, yes. You need to train your ear somehow.
Right.
And you have to study. Yeah, it's not for everyone, and it's definitely not something that you'll hear once and you'll say, oh, yes, I'm liking this, and I'm going to buy 100 CDs or whatnot of metal music. It doesn't work that way.
And to actually be a heavy metal musician, you can't just do that. You know, you can't just like pick up a guitar and 5 minutes later you're Randy Rhodes or you know, like.
Or Alexei Lyon, yeah.
Yeah, it's just not like that. In fact, my brother is a musician, and you know, he started out tone deaf. And he plays by ear now, and he trained himself, but he started with lessons from somebody who knew what they were doing. And he went from being completely tone deaf and playing no musical instruments at all to playing 7 different musical instruments and singing. But it's dedication. He did that.
It does. And I'm going to give a similar example, more spectacular, actually. There is a guy, I don't know if you're aware of him, is the guy who founded the band called Children of Bodom now.
Okay.
It used to be called Inhearted 20-something, almost 30 years ago. Anyway, this guy started at 13 to start studying guitar. He didn't graduate high school, let alone college. Thank goodness for him that he's old enough that he was able to drop school, because now you're forbidden from doing that in Finland. And he eventually ended up founding his own academy. Now it's called the Alexei Lyon Academy, where even he himself teaches, and other great guitarists throughout the world, throughout the scene, also now live there, essentially, and teach other people guitar. The guy essentially, pretty much self-taught and autodidact. But, you know, he ended up making a lot of money and also producing a lot of very good content. Heavy metal and thrash metal fans particularly, and death metal fans, will definitely know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
And then to have I don't remember the name of the outlet, because I don't really read, you know, I don't read metal press. I just listen to metal music. And I have been listening for whatever, almost 20 years. There was an outlet, I don't remember, I think it was, I don't want to pin a name, because if I get it wrong, then, anyway, said that, oh my God, there's too much whiteness and
too much
masculinity in the metal scene, and oh my God, they promote white supremacist views, and I'm like, Why don't you start doing what Alexi Laiho did, teach yourself, work for 20 years, and then, well, you'll get the notoriety that he got. I mean, it's not really that complicated. It really is an even playing field. I mean, if you have talent, you'll succeed. If not, well, no. And especially now, I mean, it was harder 20 years ago when you were at the mercy of various labels and whatnot. But now when you can self-promote on the internet and you can... there's really no excuse. And in reality, the metal scene is probably one of the most diverse one. I mean, there's metal in Zimbabwe and Senegal, and then there's metal in Iran, there's metal in Japan, there's metal everywhere.
Yeah, there's probably no place that music exists that does not have metal. But my point about my brother's situation was that, you know, he didn't get from that. He didn't pick up a guitar one day, and the next day he's playing seven different instruments.
Absolutely not.
He practiced 12 hours a day. I would come home, from just being out and about doing things. He'd get up on a Saturday morning and he would be, you know, practicing his guitar, listening to music and using a system that he bought for developing an ear for music. He asked me to help him, you know, by testing him using keys on our piano and stuff like that. He'd have me play the key and have me play a note, and then he'd tell me what it was, and I'd tell him whether he got it right. And, you know, I watched him develop his ear, and I listened to him develop his skill with the guitar. You know, he started out sounding like a couple of cats fighting in the back alley and ended up making absolutely beautiful and touching music, and music that, you know, it makes you want to dance, or music that'll lift your spirits, or, you know, it was a neat metamorphosis to watch, but it was definitely a gig thing and not just a coolness thing. Like, people think of heavy metal as being the coolest thing, and it is, but it is definitely a gig thing if you're producing music, because you have to be very dedicated to training your brain.
Yeah, and I think he can also claim the title of underprivileged. I mean, some others are privileged to being born with a very good musical ear.
Yeah, he definitely. I would call him underprivileged when it comes to when it comes to that. And he demonstrated that people who say, you know, latent talent is everything, are full of crap. His latent talent was art. Was drawing and painting, and, you know, he could create a picture on anything. I don't know if my mom still has it, but he had a picture that he drew from her garden on a piece of limestone with chalk that was just absolutely beautiful. And he drew comics and everything like that, but he decided he wanted to learn music. That's what being a nerd or a geek is really all about. You decide you want to learn something, you pick up and learn it. And I think that's why social justice warriors are never going to fit into nerd or geek culture, because they don't get that.
They don't like to work. You know, there is this proverb that goes around in my country. For anything, there is 1% inspiration and talent and 99% transpiration or sweating.
Yeah.
So that's really how things tend to work, not just in art, in all other fields, including programming, although you can say programming is a form of art as well, but there's a separate debate about that. Now, this is something that I ask every guest, so I'll ask you too. How do you lean politically? How would you describe your worldview? You mentioned egalitarianism earlier in the interview. I'm not an egalitarian, for instance. So how would you describe your worldview?
It's hard for me to say I actually politically lean at all. Because my whole family went through a metamorphosis politically. I have viewpoints from both sides of the sort of fence that divides America, although it doesn't really divide much anymore. But I'm more of a libertarian person than anything. I'm not right leaning on everything. I'm not left leaning on everything. I'm more leaning towards the areas that I support politically, not being manipulated by authoritarianism. So while I
part of the Leave Us Alone coalition,
part of the Leave Us Alone coalition, while I'm against discrimination against people on the basis of characteristics that don't determine their value, you know, and that's all of the various things, you know, race, sex, sexuality, religion, gender, all that stuff. I'm against that discrimination. I'm also against enforcing, imposing government control on relationships between individuals, you know. So my sort of response to that, I'm not necessarily for some of the marriage laws changes that people have proposed in the direction that they've proposed them. I don't like the use of the word marriage by the government because too many people consider it a religious term. Mm-hmm. And I don't think that the government should be engaging in religious enforcement.
As far as I would be all for, the government shouldn't be in the marriage business at all.
Right. I mean, they can enforce a civil contract. You make a contract with somebody to share property and custody. You can be in breach of contract and there can be legal ramifications for that. But the government shouldn't be telling two people you have to stay together for the rest of your life, or we're going to punish one of you by making you pay the other one for 18 years to raise children that the first one's not allowed to see anymore, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I think if the government's going to offer a benefit to people for being married, they don't really have a right to place religious limitations on who can be involved in that contract. But it really shouldn't be treated as a religious institution if the government's going to be involved in it. It should be a civil contract. And if it's going to be treated as a religious institution, then the government should keep their nose out of it. You know, okay. And that's the way I am with pretty much everything. You know, the drug laws, the fiscal laws, everything. If there's going to be a morality associated with it, and it's going to be based on somebody's ideological outlook, then the government needs to keep their nose out of it. And if the government's going to be involved, then it needs to be strictly based on logic, and it needs to be strictly based on preservation of individual rights and civil rights.
So I take it that you do place freedom of association above anything else. I mean, let me put it this way. Would you think that I should be arrested or shot if I make a bar, let's say, and I enforce the rules? Look, this bar is only for men and only for men between the ages of 20 and 40, and we all smoke. If you don't like it, get the fuck out.
I think that should be perfectly legal. In fact, I don't think anybody has any reason to complain about that under a system of free association, because if they don't like it, they can make their own bar. You know, okay, fine, I can't come into your bar, then I'll create a bar that has conditions that I like. Everybody can come in, you know. And if you don't want to come in, then you don't have to.
Yeah, that's the thing. I mean, most people who say they are against discrimination, they tend to associate an authoritarian look of it. And that's why I asked that for clarification.
Yeah.
Because, you know, for instance, I think it's absurd and not good business, actually. It's not profitable to exclude, let's say, for instance, let's make a Negro-only bar or a white-only bar or things like that. I think it's not good business. You're leaving money on the table, and you shouldn't do that if you're a capitalist.
But
on the other hand, if the individual wants that and they have their customers and they have their fan base, I should not be allowed to shut down their business other than through legitimate means of property, namely to refuse to do business with them.
Well, there's also an added benefit to leaving people open to do that. So you find out who are the types of people who would do that. You find out who's the person that's going to exclude blacks. And then you know that about that person. And mm-hmm. you can respond to that person accordingly. You know, how you trust that person in other business endeavors can be affected by that. Whereas if the government forces their way in, you know, that type of prejudice can be hidden. And that individual ends up, you could be doing business with that individual on a different level or in a different area and have no idea that you're dealing with someone who might be unfair to you because you're black.
Yeah, it hides information and it hinders the price system. It hinders the free flow of information. And yeah, it does tend to take certain views outside of the visible realm.
And outside of public scrutiny.
Yes, and when you take these kinds of views, any sort of views, actually, it doesn't matter which kind of them, when you take them into the underground, they tend to become even more extreme.
Yep, they fester. That's the other thing. You get somebody that behaves that way, and they have to be public about it. They also are unable to avoid confronting other people's views. They have their safe space because they have to hide. Now, if they're not hiding and they have to deal with the general public seeing their behavior and responding to their behavior, then they have the opportunity to learn better. And it helps all around if we don't hide these things, even though they're terrible. The world's ugliness, the ugliest things in the world, are the things that should be uncovered first. Because if we don't, we just turn them it goes from being stage one, where you can actually treat it, to stage four, where it turns into something that is too big and too ugly and too damaging to be removed. And it ends up killing the ability of human beings to interact with each other. It's wrong to let that stuff hide and fester.
Yeah, and to be also even completely fair, if we don't believe in freedom of speech and association for people we despise, then we don't believe it. Don't believe in that at all.
That's true as well.
It's really that simple. I mean, for instance, I've heard that there was some international organization who put pressure on a Thai business that had a bar with a Nazi theme. And everyone was like, oh my God, that's offensive and whatnot. And they pressured them to shut down. And then they eventually opened again because, well, they couldn't really force them to keep it shut down. And, you know, everyone was like, oh my God, that's absurd. That shouldn't exist. And I'm like, well, I usually drink my coffee in a Soviet themed bar. So, I mean, and if we can allow bars promoting Stalinist themes, then why not any other sort of totalitarian theme? That's one thing. And the second thing is, why should it be banned? I mean, if it's banned, they might forget about it.
Yeah, yeah, you definitely don't want to forget that those things happened. And of course, if you don't like something, you don't necessarily have to be involved in it either.
Absolutely.
You know?
Absolutely.
And of course, if you really don't like something, you can do what we do quite frequently at Honey Badger Radio and ridicule the shit out of it.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's the thing. I mean, the people purporting totalitarianism and censorship and whatnot, they tend to portray themselves as very tolerant and open. But in my view, it's usually extremists like me who are tolerant, because, you know, I wouldn't advocate for the shutdown of a location that promotes, in my view, degenerate values. Because, well, it's their freedom to promote their degenerate values. At best, I might write about them and say, don't go there because it's degenerate. But I would never attempt to use the force of my own or the state to shut it down. Why that? It's insane. That's intolerant. That's genuine intolerance, trying to shut down for good individuals or businesses and whatnot that don't agree with you. And that's usually what our philosophical opponents, the social justice warriors, tend to do. And one of their arguments is that they're being intersectionally oppressed. So do you feel intersectionally oppressed by capitalism? And what's your view on the free market in general?
Oh, I don't feel intersectionally oppressed by anything. I mean, I am a mostly white American woman. I am the least oppressed person in the world, you know. And that's even with being at the lower income echelons, you know, in the United States. If I'd have been upper middle class or wealthy, I'd even have more claim to being one of the least oppressed people in the world. It saddens me to see a lot of American women acting downtrodden when we have greater opportunity and greater freedom to grab that opportunity by the horns and ride it wherever we want to go, than women anywhere else. And than men in most parts of the world.
You still do have a lower life expectancy than women in Europe.
Yeah.
Not by much, but.
That's probably because of the way our lifestyles here.
Yeah, absolutely. In the US, so, absolutely.
I think we don't drink enough beer. I don't feel oppressed by that. As far as a free market is concerned, that goes right along with freedom of association. I have a lot of faith in people's ability to guide their own lives on a personal level. You know, I mean, we need to be able to access information, and there's some information that it helps to have someone to guide you through it. Like if you want to be a neurosurgeon, as opposed to if you want to be a photographer, which can be largely self-taught. For the most part, I don't think that infringing on freedom of association or freedom of doing business is actually helpful to the general public. I don't think it protects people. I think it prevents growth. And there has to be like sensible regulations. You know, there has to be things like if somebody commits genuine fraud in their business, then there has to be some way that the consumer has recourse for that. You know, whether it's boycotting or whether it's actually going through a process to get their money back because they bought something and the business lied about what it was. You know, those are normal things. But to come in and use regulations to control how much a corporation can profit just for the sake of controlling profits and things that politicians are starting to do now and have been doing for years in the United States, I think that's dysfunctional. And it's abusive both to the business owner and to the consumer, because it affects the consumer's ability it affects the choices that are available to the consumer. So it affects the consumer's ability to obtain things.
Yeah, absolutely, because it messes with the price eventually. I mean, if you put an extra tax on, let's say, cigarettes, because that's popular these days, it will only make them more expensive. And usually the government's rationale for that is, well, we want to discourage smoking. And I'm like, well, if putting higher taxes on cigarettes discourages smoking, then what does higher taxes on labor do?
Sorry, I just had a technical. What does higher taxes on what do?
On labor, on work.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, definitely. Discourages employment. And yeah. Here's a real good example. I went for two different degrees in college that were not bright choices for me. And a part of it was, you know, there's all this, everybody talks about women not being encouraged to make something of themselves. I was expected to go to college from the time I was a little kid. And I wasn't really focused enough to go when I went. And I should have waited a few years and become more of an adult before I did. In any case, because I did drop out, most of my employment, aside from my professional work as a photographer, most of my employment has been in the lower wage areas. A lot of it's been in lower wage areas in healthcare and retail. And every time the minimum wage has gone up, my hours got cut. That was like the first response of a business. And there was, you know, I'm seeing this also with people who I work with now. I work with intellectually disabled adults, and there was just legislation passed that required a wage increase for intellectually disabled adults working in the United States who were collecting disability and then working on the side for a little extra income. So basically, they're not capable of earning a self-supporting living because of their disabilities. Various disabilities can be a part of this. And it's not just intellectually disabled.
And if the law would be respected, they would lose their benefits, right?
Well, basically, that was the plan, I think. What ended up happening, though, is that because most of these people really can't do the level of work it takes to earn them a living, they can't be consistently reliable for an employer due to various types of disabilities that were included in this law, their employers ended up cutting hours and letting people go. So what the law really has resulted in within the community is a lot of people either losing their jobs or having their work hours not just cut, but dramatically cut, and their income actually dropped. And it was the same thing that I saw with mine. Every time the minimum wage went up, when I was working more minimum wage jobs, my hours would be cut. And I would have, my employer would drop jobs. So there would be fewer people at the workplace to do the number of jobs that was being done. I worked at a nursing home that violated state and I think federal law regarding how many people were supposed to be on the floor at a given time, and because they just couldn't afford to bring in, or they didn't think they could afford to bring in people from temp agencies and stuff when people called in sick. So the minimum you're supposed to have is one aide to 14 patients. They had one aide to 28 patients at a time.
That's the thing that most politicians don't seem to understand. A business doesn't have the opportunity the possibility to just print more money.
Right.
A business actually has to stay solvent, has to have a balanced budget, and the books need to be balanced. So when you force them to spend more on something, in this case on labor, they were going to cut their consumption of that particular product, this time labor. Labor is just a product, it's just another service, it's not something special, it's just like buying chewing gum. It really is that same thing.
And it is a terrible disservice to the people that politicians are claiming to support and advocate for when they make promises about this is going to happen because we're raising the minimum wage. Your standard of living is going to go up. Every time the minimum wage went up, my standard of living went down. And then right about the time it starts to catch up with that dip, they start talking about raising the minimum wage again.
And can you imagine, there was a time in 1988, I think, when the New York Times used to title the right minimum wage is zero.
Yeah, well, the right minimum wage is not to have one. There is not zero, but the fact that people can negotiate their own deals.
Yeah, the right legal minimum wage should be zero. Yeah. There should not be such regulation. Now, since we are on the topic of politicians, let's get a bit more into U.S. politics. There's presidential elections this year in the United States. Have you gotten the chance to form a view on the candidates in this year's race?
Well, the way I see it, we are looking at a race between the political establishment and the corporate establishment. And when I mention the corporate establishment, I know I've just talked about the free market and everything. Corporations do have the capacity to become almost like little governments in and of themselves if they are overly supported by the political establishment.
Absolutely.
Which is another wrong thing for the government to do. And they pick and choose which areas of the corporate community they're going to support. And that is just as wrong.
Yeah, it's no longer a free market when the government picks winners and losers.
Right. But I would take, at this point, I would take corporate over political simply because the political establishment has screwed things up so very badly and has become so abusive and so, it's gotten to the point where our president is acting like he's a king. He's making decrees and enforcing them. He's using a presidential power that is intended for small things. He's using it for big things. It's gotten to the point where the political establishment has forgotten the system of checks and balances that was written into the U.S. Constitution. And I don't know if the corporate establishment is going to do the same. But at this point, the devil we know is so bad that it's worth taking a chance on the devil we don't. And so I can't say that I'm 100% leaning towards a particular candidate, but I'm actually really looking at Trump. I'm taking a very serious look at Trump simply because I'm so fed up with the current political establishment that, it's it feels like time to get out of that, even if it looks like taking a gamble on somebody who may be just as bad. He may not be just as bad. You know, just could the chance worse. That he may not be. I don't know. What we're doing now is headed us, it's heading our country towards basically a breakdown, you know, to not being the United States anymore.
No, I completely agree with your analysis. Now, for instance, I started following the primaries from day one. And you know, from where I'm looking, I'm particularly interested in their foreign policy. The only time I even considered thinking about a Democrat was when James Webb was still in the race. I mean, that guy was what used to be called a conservative Democrat. You know, he was against affirmative action. He was for a more assertive foreign policy, which is what I prefer. He was doable. I mean, he was doable. But once he dropped out, I mean, the Democrat field looks like, wait a minute. So there's a choice between a very corrupt old hag and the Bolshevik. I mean, are you serious? Yeah. Are you fucking kidding me? If someone had told me in 1990 that there will be a time when the United States will have a Bolshevik with real chances of winning the presidency, I was like, no, that's not possible. It's completely impossible.
If you look back at the history of the Democrat Party, they've been like that for cool. about a century. You know, the elitist socialist mentality that you see today, it's always been there. And the Republican Party has always had its own authoritarianism, their religious authoritarianism. Mm-hmm.
Although that's a more newer thing when they started the alliance with the evangelicals. Until then, it wasn't really that.
Yeah, prior to that, it wasn't quite so bad. And I think that's part of the reason why I've been so disillusioned with the Republican Party, even though I registered as a Republican when I was 18, and I'm still registered with the party, so I'll be voting in the primary on Tuesday. But I even though I have a more libertarian perspective, and I'd love to see the party take a more libertarian perspective again, but I don't expect it to happen because it's been
politics
sort of taken over
culture. And if you look at the more younger conservatives, I'm thinking of, let's say, Ben Shapiro or things of that nature. They do lean far more libertarian. And Ben Shapiro would have all the ingredients to be an authoritarian. He's an Orthodox Jew. I mean, you can't get more religious authoritarian than that. Yet, he always says, well, I agree with the evangelicals on religious grounds, but they should not have the right to impose their religious grounds on everyone else, even though I agree with them. And that's the kind of thing that libertarians tend to have. Regardless of my moral opinion, I don't think I should have the right to impose it upon everyone else.
Right. That's where I sit too. I don't agree with imposing your moral. And this is something that there's been news stories I've been watching that have just got me appalled. The story of the clerk, the clerk of courts, I can't think of her name, in one county in Tennessee that has a moral objection to signing marriage licenses for gay couples.
Dave is something. He's a Democrat. Yeah.
She's I don't remember whether she's a Democrat or a Republican, but
she's a Democrat.
Is she a Democrat?
100% sure.
But yes. The Republicans are standing up for her and everything, which is fine. What bothers, because she's not stopping other people in the office from signing those. So she's not imposing a view on other people. She's not preventing other people from getting their marriage licenses. She's choosing not to participate in
yes,
in,
but you see, this is the SJW mentality. You'll be made to care.
Well, that's just it. She is now being targeted. People are coming from outside of that county to that courthouse. They're going there when they're closer to other outlets where they could get their marriage license, and demanding that she be the person to sign their marriage license because they can make her do it. And it's like, instead of being advocates for tolerance, they're actually being advocates for intolerance.
That's what happens when the state takes a side.
Yeah. And like if my husband had been female, it would not have changed my interest in him at all. I'm bisexual. If I wanted to get married to a woman, it wouldn't, you know, I would not go looking for somebody who doesn't want to sign my marriage license. That to make that your focus is absolutely outright hateful.
And it also tells something about the persons. I mean, how much of a lowlife can you be to travel into a different county just to go out of spite of some low-level clerk?
It really? Would be as much bullying as that clerk traveling out of county to stop other clerks from handing out marriage licenses.
There you go, yes.
You know? And it's one of those things that, like, I am all for people having the freedom to engage in their relationships however they want. But that includes people who don't want to have a relationship with you. Yep. People who, even if it's a business relationship, people who don't want to engage with you, you don't have the right to make them engage with you just because you've had a rough time getting people to acknowledge your right to engage with others.
Yeah, freedom of association starts with freedom not to associate.
Right.
Just like freedom of speech starts with the very appalling and offensive and hateful speech.
But yeah.
If you don't believe in that, then you don't believe in freedom of association.
Yep,
speaking
exactly.
of freedom of association, probably last question. Let's get a bit on Milo Yiannopoulos's dangerous faggot tour of around the U.S. universities and also British and Canadian. Do you think that's helpful or it's probably irrelevant on the long run? And tell me
well,
a bit more
honest,
about what you think about the campus culture.
I haven't followed it extensively, but I could compare what I've seen of it. Like I've seen some reactions to it and everything, and I could compare what I've seen of it to what I've seen of men's rights activists who travel and speak. Both male and female, in the protests that I've seen against Warren Farrell's speeches, Janice Fiumingo's speeches, Christina Hoff Sommers' speeches, and all of the
more
people,
recently Paul
know,
Nathanson just a
and
week,
what,
one
what
week
Sage,
ago,
yeah, and what Sage Gerard went through at his university,
yeah,
just for wanting to have a organization to support men on campus that wasn't controlled by women. You know, and it's goes right back, like you said, to freedom of association. If there are people on campus who want to hear Milo Yiannopoulos speak, they have the right to invite him in and engage with him and listen to what he has to say without other people on campus coming in and telling them they can't hear what he has to say. They have the right to listen to him. They have the right to know what his opinions are. And they, you know, and the other people have the right to disagree with him. And they have the right to set up another conference or meeting or discussion or bring in a speaker with an opposing viewpoint to counter what he has to say, you know.
And it's not like Milo has been unreasonable. I mean, I watched two nights ago his speech in Pittsburgh University, I think it was, where, you know, there was his speech was shorter than the Q&A. I mean, he allotted like almost 2 hours just for Q&A. And, you know, certain social justice warriors were civilized enough to be quiet during the speech and then ask questions which they thought would demolish his argument. Now, they failed in that, but at least they did what normal people do, which is listen and then engage. You don't have to listen and believe unless you're an idiot. But, but you know, they were civilized. Now, on the other hand, the significant majority of SJWs just went in there just to disrupt.
This is something that drives me nuts.
It does. You know,
people come in and instead of taking the time to hear what somebody has to say and tell them why they think it's wrong or ask them questions about it or maybe learn a different viewpoint, God forbid.
Organize a counter conference. How noble would be that? I mean,
and then they come in and they get all noisy and then no discussion can happen at all.
Yeah, I mean, if you don't like what Milo has to say, why don't you invite Jessica Valenti in your own conference?
Yeah.
Because, you know, every time I've seen politically incorrect people attending politically correct conferences, they didn't went there to protest and blow bullhorns and whatnot. They went there, sat, listen, and then ask pertinent questions. Now, of course,
that gets you kicked out.
That gets you kicked out, and they don't like when that happens. Whereas in Milo's case, when SJWs asked what they thought was uncomfortable or uncomfortable questions, nobody was being kicked out. The only ones being kicked out were the ones blowing bullhorns and trying to disrupt.
The far left
has gone so far left that it's no longer the case. I mean, someone was complaining that, oh, there is a lot of division and we no longer assume good faith on the part of the opposite. Well, I do. I usually do. But when you come into my event and start blowing bullhorns and try to get it shut down, what kind of respect and the presumption of good faith should I have?
Yeah, there is no good faith in that. But the comparison I would make, it's not just to the fact that they kick out and we don't, unless there's a genuine disruption. They feel entitled to disrupt speech they don't like.
Because it's harmful.
Entitled to shut down other people's conferences, other people's talks, other people's conventions, other people's panels, to the point where they'll contact authorities in charge of games conventions and other geek area conventions and stuff like that, where it's supposed to be an area of open thought, and demand that they not allow certain groups of people to hold panels and speak at those locations and those events. But if you so much as ask a single question or answer a question they've asked in a way they don't like in their panels, you get kicked out. So one side feels entitled to entirely shut down the other side's speech, and they don't consider it harassment when they do that or authoritarianism or anything like that. Whereas the other side isn't even allowed to question their side's speech without being accused of bullying. How dare you ask us to think? How dare you have your own opinion? How dare you demand to think for yourselves and not let us dictate what your experiences are?
That's coming from the social group and the political ideology that says that lived experiences trump facts. So, you know, when Milo says that, look, I'm a dangerous faggot and I don't think homosexuality is innate, which are the two most offensive things that he ever said, that's, you know, his lived experience doesn't count.
Yeah.
So, you know, only some sort of correct lived experience. Those are the only ones that count. To be honest, I take a more dim view, because when I look at these students and I say, look, I'm an atheist, but when I look at them and, oh my God, these are the leaders of tomorrow. God help us.
Yeah. Well, and the sad thing is, people aren't recognizing it, but that sense of entitlement that they're displaying is the utmost in intellectual laziness. You know, and like I've talked about uncovering and exposing the ugliness in the world in order to treat it. That's one of the hardest things to do. When you look at something that is terrible as a means of confronting the terrible possibilities within the human psyche in order to better the human response to the world around, you know, and in order to better the ability of people on a individual level and on a society-wide level to relate to each other and to support each other individually and to support their community and things like that. It takes a lot of work to overcome our natural tendencies as a species that evolved as a competitive species, you know, not just with nature but in the world, but with each other. It takes a lot of work to overcome those tendencies in order to be a cooperative society of people that engage with each other and support each other and associate in positive ways with each other. And
there is no better system to ensure cooperation between people who hate each other than capitalism.
Right.
I mean, as Walter E. Williams likes to say, do you think the potato farmers in Texas wake up every day at 4 a.m. to work their ass off just so New Yorkers can have mashed potatoes on their table? Do you think they love the New Yorkers? No, they fucking hate the New Yorkers. But They do it because they want more for themselves. They want more profits. They want more revenue. So capitalism tends to mitigate these things a lot better than government fiat and the
right
and whatnot.
But what I'm talking about at universities is that it's the epitome of laziness, really, to hide from all of that and try to come up with an intricate set of rules by which people have to behave in order and make it formulaic rather than intellectual. Because then you don't have to think about it, and you don't have to confront the darkness within yourself as a person. You can pretend you're doing that. You can, you know, claim to have like white guilt and you know, oh, I'm so sorry for what my ancestors did, even if your ancestors didn't do anything, but they had the same skin color as people who did. It's easier to fall back on stuff like that than it is to look at the person sitting at the table across from you and actually consider that person's experiences and just, you know, make an effort to relate instead of following a formula.
Yeah, well,
it's easier to use call and response.
Since you mentioned the white guilt, I have to put this in there. When Milo was confronted with this kind of, you know, anti-white bigotry that tends to come from supremacist movements such as Black Lives Matter and others, he was like, well, what did you say? Do white people do this and that? Yeah, we invented all the cool shit. If you don't like white people, can I have your iPhone, please?
I like that.
That's how I like to treat these kinds of things. I mean, if you really hate Western civilization that much, if you really hate white people that much, then can you please move into, I don't know, let's say Nigeria, and can I have your iPhone and your house and your internet connection, your computer?
Yeah.
I mean, really, it's not really that complicated. Now, we're 7 minutes past the hour. Last question. Will you come to London this July?
I'm planning on it. A Voice for Men and Honey Badgers are trying to send both me and Karen, and there will be a fundraiser to help us get there. I won't be able to go without the fundraiser because, like I said, my income's not real high. But I am planning on it, and so when the fundraiser comes out, I'll promote the fundraiser and everything, and in order to try to get there, so that I can, like, I got to meet a lot of people and listen to what a lot of people had to say at the first conference in Michigan, and that was a wonderful experience. And I really hope to be able to do the same thing and listen to a lot of perspectives from people in Europe, whoever can get to London for the conference.
In theory, I mean, not just in theory, but in practice, I'll be there. I'll be speaking about ideology. It's going to be fun. And how ideologies are formed and how do they impact real life. It's going to be very, very fun. Hopefully I'll get to convince Mike to extend a little bit the speaking time because, yeah, whatever. All right. Maybe we should call it here because this is the age of low attention span, and if we expand much further past 70 minutes, there's usually fewer people watching it. And I know that from experience. Just 3 hours from now, I have to go live on the Voice for Men for Voice of Europe. And that there we usually stay online for two hours. And it's far fewer viewers than when I stay out on just for 1 hour or 70 minutes. So, yeah, I guess we're going to have to adapt to the market on this one.
Yep, that's what you do.
All right. Thank you a lot for coming here, and I'm looking forward to shake hands in London. I really
definitely
do.
And thanks for having me on.
All right, then. With that being said, this concludes episode 5 of Freedom Alternative Interviews. So, with that being said, thank you all for watching. See you soon.